Alex, you're in the property investing business, and
yes,
I just want to describe the way you're a very hands-on kind of investor. You're very much involved with like doing up houses, renovating them, converting mm-hmm. them, turning them into homes and multiple occupancy. You do like yeah. coaching. You get groups of people together. You'll bring investors in. You'll bring builders together. So you're very, very, very hands-on. You give talks. Yeah. You give seminars about investing and the mindset of wealth creation. And I just wanted to give people that summary up front so they know what to expect from this conversation. So how's cool. it going?
Yeah, awesome. Really, really, really awesome. I've got two joint venture groups at the moment who are actually joint venturing together. So it's an exciting time. Very exciting time. Busy couple of weeks, but yeah.
Now, the last time you were on my podcast 4 years ago, I think it was yeah. 4 years ago, and things were already going well then. You had loads of stuff on the go. You had loads of property. It was really happening. And in that time, I guess you've been doing more and more. So give us a rundown of the last 4 years. Like, what's progressed in that time?
Okay, cool. I think the biggest thing that's progressed for me is helping other people do what I do. So I still do stuff for myself. There should be a mortgage completing today on the last holiday let development that I did. But mainly what I've been focusing on is the coaching side of it and helping other people do it, because I was getting more and more people calling me saying, can we just meet up for a coffee? I want to pick your brains. And it got to the point where it wasn't workable to just meet people for coffee. So I started, I think 3 years ago, I came up with a 4-month money bootcamp program and took 5 people through that. And they wanted to keep meeting. So we'd meet every month, one day for a workshop at my place, and then stay in touch on WhatsApp and webinars in between the time. And when it finished, they didn't want it to finish. And it was really that group who drove what I do now, because they wanted to keep meeting and they wanted to keep working together as a group. And I literally didn't have anything for them. And don't believe in meeting just for the sake of it and taking people's money just for the sake of it. So it took me about 8 months, and it was various different things slotting into place to figure out kind of how to keep working with them and how to give them content that would work. And it was varying different things that kind of all slotted into place that got me to come up with Joint Venture Mastermind, which was basically taking them from, okay, you've sorted out your money, now let's invest in property. So I'd say, yeah, the last 4 years has been spent working on that and actually doing it with people. I'm not a big fan of courses just for the sake of it. I'm a big fan of getting people to actually achieve what they want to achieve. So the way that I work with the Joint Venture Mastermind is we actually set up a company and actually buy properties, and they will actually become financially free over the next few years. So it's very, in the same way that my property stuff was hands-on, my coaching stuff's really hands-on as well. You know, I get people to fulfill on what they want. It's not just, oh yeah, this is how you do it, off you go. And now I have 4 groups. So 2 are into Joint Venture Mastermind. The 2 coming behind those are turning into Joint Venture Mastermind in January. And I have a new group, a new money bootcamp starting in January as well. So that's probably taking up most of my time is making sure all those groups are working. And all that it takes to make that work. You know, I don't take it lightly. We're writing wills, powers of attorney. We're dealing with tax planning, you know, everything that it takes to not only become financially free, but to manage that wealth, because all these people are already probably got businesses of some kind themselves. So, you know, there's a lot involved in doing it.
So we've got a mutual friend, James, and I saw James recently because I wasn't aware of everything you were doing. I mean, I knew you were doing stuff, but I didn't know the details. And I met James for dinner.
It's very secret what I do. I don't advertise it. That's probably why. Unless you hear about it from someone in one of my groups, you won't hear about it.
Yeah, and you limit the amount of people, because you work with people properly. There's a limited amount of people you can work with, isn't there? Like you say,
yeah, a maximum of 6 a year, and usually, actually, from the money boot camp, normally 4 people will go through. That, you know, there'll be someone who it's not quite right for them, or they do the money bootcamp and go, yeah, that's great, but I don't want to do the property. So it really is only 4 to 6 people a year that kind of join the tribe, as it were.
Yeah, like you say, you're not just selling a coaching program, getting on stage, doing an ebook, and you know, and like it's not that kind of thing. It's like real world kind of coaching, isn't it? So James was telling me, and the way James described it, he almost seemed surprised with himself. He was like, I can't believe it. You know, I got involved with this group. I didn't really intend to. You know, Alex invited me over one day and then I got involved with this thing. And then we've done two properties this year. I think they renovated one and they've just bought another or something like that under your coaching. And he was saying the interesting thing about the group, I don't know if it's four or five people, but he said...
They're four. They've lost one. So they're four now. They were five.
He was saying the interesting thing is, like, all the people in the group are doing different things. You know, one of them, James, is doing like the accountancy and paperwork and legal side of it. Somebody else is doing building. Somebody else is contributing money. And he was saying everyone feels like they're not doing enough or not doing their fair share. Because I said,
yeah, it's hilarious.
Yeah, it's funny because that's counterintuitive. I said to him, like, you know, surely with a partnership like that, somebody ends up doing like more of the work and they feel resentful and other people are being lazy. He said, no, it's the opposite. Everyone feels like they're not doing enough. Isn't that weird?
Yeah, it's mad. And actually, what's really funny is that in his group, that's just happened to James, and it's just happened to one of the other guys where he'd said exactly that in our last workshop, which was last week. And he's now messaged me yesterday saying, holy shit, I'm in overwhelm. I've got so much to do. So it's like it comes to each of the group at different times. And it was the same for James. James was really feeling like, you know, oh, I'm not doing enough. And then bang, all of the accounting stuff came in. And it was like, yeah, oh, my God, there's a lot to do now in that section. But it makes it, you know, the power of joint venturing is you're pooling all the resources. So, yes, they'll have times when they're like super busy, but then most of the time it's like, oh, wow, this is easy. I've literally, you know, like James said, they've renovated a house this year and sold it. They've taken the money from that to buy an HMO, which they completed on last week. And they're now looking at joint venturing with the other group, which was the very first group, on a bigger project, a refurb to flip, to create money to then put into the next deal. So, you know, there's no way that any of those individuals would have done that in a year on their own. And actually, there's a certain argument to say they would have never have done it, because it's just the volume of work to do that on your own plus a full-time job. It's huge.
Yeah, that's exactly what James said. He said, I'd never have done this. I'd never have even thought of it. It's way outside my comfort zone. You know, he said, I would never have got involved with two property deals if it weren't for being, you know, in this group.
Yeah. And it's fun as well. Like I was on a Zoom call so that we could all see each other with Luther from another group, James and myself, while James was bidding on an auction just the other day, Monday or Tuesday. They didn't get the property. It went too high. We had a maximum and that was going to be a joint venture with the two groups. And it's really fun to actually do that, to be on a call listening to the auction and, you know, they're bidding. It's serious stuff and they'll get financially free, but it's also a really good crack as well, you know, doing stuff like that. So
yeah, there's a buzz in it and excitement
absolutely
to it all, isn't there? Yeah, I can tell. Yeah. I can tell you find it fun, you know. I'm wondering, in terms of you're like the team leader that kind of keeps the group together and makes sure it's functioning, and if there's any problems, like what percentage of it is managing, you know, the intercommunication between the team, and what percentage of it is actual like technical property stuff that you do?
I would say it could almost be up to 90% of dealing with the human side and probably 10% property. When all is said and done, property is actually really easy. It's us that get in the way of all of it. So it's the emotion, dealing with the money, figuring out who's doing what, and all of that. So in the groups, everyone has to deal with their own lives as well. If people just want to just do property and not face or deal with anything else in their lives, they don't work with me, because I'll piss them off because I won't let it go. If they're having a breakdown in their own lives, it's going to affect their money, whether they like it or not. I don't believe you can kind of cut off a section of yourself and just work on the money and the property and pretend like we're all robots.
Yeah. And
at the end of the day, human beings, we're all dealing with our crap. You know, it took me dealing with my self-esteem and my daddy issues to get to where I am today. It doesn't just happen by magic. People who are successful and people who deal with wealth don't do it by accident. There are a few people who become extremely wealthy without dealing with any of their stuff, but it's very rare.
People
think they don't have to deal with their childhoods to succeed in life are blind to that, you know, side of things. And yes, you can get through it. You can get through life by going to the pub every weekend, like a lot of people do, and, you know, getting through the week, drinking at the weekend, going back to your job, but it's not a life. So we deal with, yeah, the whole person and everything that everyone's got that they're dealing with.
Yeah, that makes sense. People got to be fully committed. Like, so if someone comes to you and they're like, right, Alex, I want to do property. I want to be rich. You know, my life's a mess. You know, I'm arguing with my partner. I'm unhappy. I hate my job. You know, I'm smoking and drinking. I'm taking drugs on the weekend. Will you work with me?
Like, well, so I'll say yes, but we're going to deal with all that shit first before we even look at a property. And then if they're up for it, great. I'm all in. You know, I can coach, you know, every area of someone's life. And if there's an area I can't deal with, or there's, you know, something that needs bigger therapy, then I recommend that people go and get that. You know, there's a certain amount that I can coach, and there's a certain amount where people need extra help. But yeah, so I'll take that on, but they're going to have to deal with all that first. I had a client, a one-to-one client a while back, and, you know, he used to joke like, oh, come on, let's get this shit out of the way so we can actually talk about property. And we'd spend, you know, an hour and a half talking about the shit, in inverted commas, and half an hour, you know, looking at the property deals going, yeah, great, do that one.
Yeah, that totally makes sense. I can see the importance of that. I've been going to therapy since the start of the year, almost a year now.
And wow,
so,
yeah.
So there's like, yeah, I'm trying.
You get it. You know exactly what I'm talking
about
then.
Yeah, I'm trying to address every area of life for sure. Yeah, so there's nothing. Yeah. I get what you mean. Now, you personally, you've done a hell of a lot of personal development on yourself. You've been getting coaching, and you've been doing like Landmark and Tony Robbins and all the NLP and everything. Like, give us a bit of an overview of your personal development journey over that. I've known you 15 years. So
yeah, it probably started when I first met you, because we met at the Yes Group in Cardiff. So that's where it first started. I'd decided to go self-employed as a chef. I didn't want to work for people anymore, so I spent 17 years as a chef before I did, you know, what I do now. And so I started through the Yes Group, actually, because my mum recommended me. She'd done all of Tony Robbins stuff and said, look, why don't you go along to the Yes Group? So I did that. I met Judy Mae Murphy and had her as a coach for a long while, did a huge amount of work with her, brilliant coach. And I guess it's like dealing with layers and considering it as a journey with personal development. So I've had various different coaches a long time. I've worked with Sarah Leather, another brilliant coach. I read and listen to audiobooks nonstop. So I've got two Springer Spaniels that I walk every day, and I'll always have someone. So at the moment it's Brené Brown and Jordan Peterson who I'm listening to, and then I have a coach as well. So I have a personal coach that I have a half hour call with on a weekly basis, and I've always had a coach of some sort, just depending on what I'm dealing with. Depends on who it is and what it is.
You're extremely proactive with your life, aren't you?
Yeah, absolutely. And I go to work on it. And I think the thing that makes the difference is it's not the number of courses I've been on. It's that when I go on the course, or I have a coach, or I read a book, I do the assignments. And that's the key that a lot of people miss. They'll read all these books, but at the end of the chapter, when it says, right, go and do this, they don't do it. So in, I think it's the 4-hour work week, when he says, you know, go and, I think you just have to like lie down in the street and just to get out of your comfort zone and then get up and walk off. Most people read that book and never do that. I did it. You know, it's like I actually do the exercises, and really I can't strenuously say it enough. That's what makes the difference. And it's the same as when I work with people, we do the work. We don't just talk about it intellectually. We get it on a cellular level.
Yeah, right. There's a funny kind of way. There's something a little bit scary about you in the sense that there's nowhere to hide with you. Like the thing that people don't want to confront and don't want to talk about, you're going to go there probably. Right?
And I won't just go, I go straight there, and I won't talk about anything else until we've gone there. And it's not for everyone. You know, there are plenty of people who will not work with me because they don't want to deal with it. And do you know what? That's fine. Everyone's got to deal with their stuff at the right time. I don't make people do anything they don't want to do, but I will not step over anything that I believe is there. So if someone's dealing with something, I will ask them, you know, what's going on, and we'll deal with it. And I think that the biggest thing is about, it's probably why I don't advertise a huge amount online, that, you know, the clients that work for me, everything's confidential. You know, we say what happens in joint venture stays in joint venture. You know, it's one of those where, you know, it's a really safe place to deal with stuff. And it's really fun and it's really exciting. It's everything. It's the whole of life. It's not just a money course or a property course. You know, that's the key. And these guys who are in the groups, I mean, they're effectively, they're so close now. You know, they've got each other's backs. They're taking care of each other. They're becoming financially free together. So when they do actually have the opportunity to not work in their day jobs anymore or go and do whatever project it is they want to do next, they've actually got a circle of friends who have been through the same thing, who they'll carry on hanging out with each other. One thing that happened to me when I left my last chef job and, you know, retired in inverted commas, I was like, shit, everyone's still working. What do I do now? You know, there's not a lot of people that get it done. There's a lot of people that talk about it getting it done, but not a lot of people actually do.
Yes.
So having that team to do it with is really, really important.
So when you left your chef in, there was like a period of kind of detaching yourself from certain social circles, was there? And is that what you mean? Like,
not even that. It was just, so my last chef job was actually a private chef for a family. I'd kind of done restaurant stuff and ended up doing private work for a Saudi Arabian family in London. And it wasn't that. It was just that we don't realize that most people are working all the time. So and I deal with this with my clients now because I've been through it the wrong way, for want of a better description. And it's the same that happens to people when they retire at 65. If they don't have the next thing and the big dream and the thing that they want to do next kind of starting to be looked at, it's a really tough time. You know, I had a good few years where I just didn't know what I wanted to do. I was proactive and I tried a lot of stuff. So I did a lot of cookery demos and supper clubs and looking into different businesses and, coaching people around food. But it just wasn't right. I did a lot of gardening, which I really enjoyed, which actually is leading me on to my next dream of having a farm, a working livestock farm. So it was very helpful to figure out who the hell I was. But after working 18 hours a day in a kitchen for 17 years, I actually didn't know who I was. I knew that I wanted to be financially free and I knew I didn't want to work in kitchens. But when all that stops, there's a massive loss of identity that I make sure people are aware this is going to happen, that they need to know what their dream is, what they want to do next, or already be building it. You know, if they're already self-employed and doing what they love, some of my clients are already doing that. But it's like they've really got to be prepared for what's next, because otherwise, I mean, that's why you hear about people retiring and dying within a year. You know, they drop dead of a heart attack because they didn't have the next thing.
Yeah.
So it's almost like they've spent their whole lives going, I can't wait till I retire. Didn't have the next thing planned. So their body goes, oh, that's it then. We're retired. Boom.
Yeah. Yeah, I can relate. Yeah, I can relate to that. When I finished with my online guitar lesson thing, you know, there was a period, a couple of years where I didn't know what I was doing. I wasn't sure what I was going to do next. I was just kind of floating and drifting.
Yeah, it's a huge identity, isn't it? Being, you know, playing guitar and being in a band and doing all that's a massive identity. You put that down. It's like, yeah. Shit, who am I now?
Yeah, that's right. And there's something that always stood out when I remember Tony Robbins saying it, progress equals happiness. I always remember him saying that, and I've always felt that to be true. Like whenever I'm feel like I'm getting somewhere, I'm working towards something, I'm progressing, that's what feels invigorating and alive and fulfilling and everything. And then anytime like I'm getting frustrated, like I don't feel like I'm making progress in my life, that's when you start feeling like, you know, sort of depressed and
yeah and that's where all the sort of struggle comes in. It's like when you reach a goal, actually the best part of reaching the goal was reaching the goal. When you actually get there, it's like, oh, it's done. What do I do now?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, spot on. And I said to someone the other day on a call about my next group, you know, what do you want? Where are you going? And they didn't know. And I was like, you know, we've got to figure this out. You can't, it's all very well getting financially free, but you've got to have a why. You've got to have something you're working towards and a reason for doing it. Otherwise, when it gets tough, you're just going to give up because there's no why behind it. Absolutely key.
You mentioned something like about holiday lets or a project you just done or something. Can you talk about that?
So it was a three-story Victorian end of terrace in Porthcawl, and I did it to live in downstairs and a four-bedroom holiday let upstairs. So it was a really funny deal, actually. Loads of investors had looked at it. The agents hadn't really helped by saying, oh, you'll never get a mortgage on this. So it was 170,000 to buy and needed completely redoing. It was already split into two flats, but that was it. You know, it was technically unmortgageable. Anyway, I managed to get a mortgage on it and buy it. And I basically did it up, completely gutted it, new kitchens, bathrooms, plumbing, electrics, the lot, took a chimney breast out to make a toilet into a shower room. And I ended up selling the downstairs flat for 170, and the upstairs got valued at 185. And I probably spent about 100,000 on it. So I've sold the downstairs flat, and the upstairs is now a holiday let, and that's the one that's there's a mortgage completing this week on, at which point I joint ventured with my mum and stepdad on this one. So they put the money in, I did all the work. So I've now got a mortgage on the upstairs flat to buy them out. So I give them back their money plus their profit. And then the upstairs just carries on running as a holiday let, and it cash flows really nicely. As a standard rental, it would probably do 600 or 700 a month, and it does between 2,000 and 4,000 a month as a holiday let.
Wow.
You have to take bills and laundry and cleaning off that, probably about 500 a month, but it cash flows really, really well, and all year round as well.
And do you put that on Airbnb?
Yeah, it's on Airbnb. It's also on TripAdvisor, and it's on Home and Away. Airbnb kind of flew into the market and did really well, but actually there are other providers now who are I'd say they're cutting in. I don't know whether they're cutting into Airbnb's income or whether they're just expanding that market even more. But we get a lot of bookings through other providers as well as Airbnb now as well.
So you really will, like, you're not the kind of person that just has got one strategy. You'll look at a thing and think, right, how can we make this work? There must be a way of making this work. That's your attitude.
Yeah, it's like the way I explain it to my clients is it's like you have a tool bag of all the things that you could do, and you have to look at a property as if you're a problem solver and go, right, well, what could we do with this property? Because if you only have one strategy, you know, like a one trick pony, you'll miss so many deals and so much potential that it still works, right, to do the same thing again and again and again, but you just, it's kind of slower and harder. And also, if that particular area in the property market goes wrong, you've got all your eggs in one basket. Whereas with me, I've got flats, I've got houses, I've got a shop, I've got a holiday let, I've got an HMO, you know, it's really spread between different things. I'm not into one thing. So, you know, if all of my houses were HMOs and the regulations suddenly changed, I've got a big issue, you know, that kind of thing.
You're like, I'm imagining, I'm kind of visualizing you're like a predator. I imagine like a property investor tiger that's kind of almost, you know, when the big cats like stalk their prey, and it's like, and then they go in and like go for the neck and wrestle it to the ground until it's they've got it. It's a bit like that, isn't it? Whereas I suppose, you know, maybe a lot of people are more like the prey.
Possibly, but you know what's interesting is that a lot of the deals that I get, so I get why that it occurs like that, but I don't have it that it's like that. Because, for example, take Victoria Avenue that I've just done. Everyone had looked at it, and it was almost like, I'm not sure I want to compare myself to a hyena, but everyone else had looked at it and thought, no, this isn't going to work, and walked away. And I came in and went, yeah, I can make this work, and did it just quietly, you know, after everyone else had looked at it. So it's not like I get in first. Quite a lot of the properties I buy have been on the market for a long time. People have looked at them, not figured out how to do it, walked away. A lot of people come to me going, oh, how do you find deals? And I'm like, in the estate agent's window. Because there's a lot of property people out there selling, you know, oh, you've got to be this master, this, that, and the other, you know, seller and strategist and whatever. Most of the deals I've bought have been in an estate agent for everyone to see. So in a way, there's something slightly more, I don't know what the word is, cunning, but even that sounds a bit, you know, underhand. It's just that I look at things and go, oh, actually, this would work. And there's also persistence as well. I just keep looking and keep looking and keep looking. I remember, I think it's Robert Kiyosaki says, it's either him or one of his guys in one of his books says, you know, you look at 100 deals online, you might view 10 in real life and you'll probably get one. You know, most people don't want to put in the work. They don't want to spend the evening looking on Rightmove. You know, Friday night when most people are down the pub, I'm on Rightmove looking at properties. It's not rocket science to a certain extent, but it's consistent and persistent action over time that gets it, you know?
Yeah. What's your feeling about the economy and things like that in terms of like interest rates, and if the economy is going up or down, like, does that affect you?
It does to a certain extent. But what a lot of people say to me, oh, you know, oh, the property market's already gone. There's no point investing in property now. And I say, well, you could say that at any point in time if you compare it to the past. But if you look into the future at what's happening, it's still viable. As far as interest rates go at the moment, I believe it's not a question of if they go up, it's when. So me personally, I'm fixing in for as long as I can. So I've just done one mortgage where I've fixed in for 10 years. And I fixed in at 4%, which some people go, oh, that's so high, you know, you could get a 2% mortgage. But if you do a 2% mortgage with a couple of grand arrangement fee that you have to then redo every 2 years, you actually end up spending more money than just paying the consistent 4% and one arrangement fee. So for me, it's about fixing in for the long term. It's about considering arrangement fees and numbers of times you've got to remortgage versus, you know, just the interest rate. And who knows? I mean, if you'd have asked me 10 years ago, do you think interest rates will stay that low for that long? I would have said, oh God, surely not. Surely it's not possible. And here we are, you know, 10 years after the crash and they're still really low.
And does Brexit concern you, or is it the same answer?
It's kind of the same answer. I think it's important for us to look at every deal at the time and make sure we've got exits. I think the biggest time that property investors get caught out is when they over leverage themselves. So people in the crash who were doing big developments to flip, they were just stuck because they had, you know, a lot of money in, no way of getting out, you know, no way of remortgaging, no way of selling. I mean, I was caught in a way on a small scale when the crash happened. I had a property that should have valued up to 140. I mean, this is way back when I think it was my sixth property that I did, should have valued up at 140, should have pulled about 40,000 out. And the banks basically said, no, the loan to value's changed now, it's 65%. And by the way, it's only valued at 100. So I ended up giving the bank another 10 grand to keep the property. So it went, you know, a 50 grand swing from, I should have had 40,000 coming to me, but I had to give them 10,000. And I was, you know, I had a lot of debt on that property that I'd done on credit cards. I actually ended up doing a deal with my dad to get myself out of it, where I paid him an interest rate of 10% to borrow the money from him instead to be able to keep the deal. So he did very well on he said, and most people would agree, was a risky deal because of what happened in the crash. And I managed to keep my property. But most, you know, if you imagine someone doing that on a bigger scale and needed 500,000, that's it, game over. And that's why a lot of people lost. So I think it's important at any one time to realize, right, if there was a crash tomorrow, what would happen? And do deals accordingly, to not get overexcited about stuff, to not get overexposed to, you know, I mean, we have to keep generally now 25% in the properties, which I think is helpful, so that people aren't going into massive negative equity if the property prices in the short term do fall. But at the end of the day, anything we do is risky. Any business we go into, if there's a crash, the chances are, you know, it's going to be a bit painful. The tax changes for me in the last couple of years, that where interest, mortgage interest isn't allowable. I mean, that's cost me, I think it'll, when all said and told, it cost me about £100,000 to pay the tax bills, to put and the finance costs to put everything into a limited company. Most landlords didn't have enough equity in their portfolios to do that. They've just had to walk away. I mean, it's why there's a lot of property on the market at the moment.
So you've just had to take that on the chin, and there's no way around it. You just had to.
So that 100,000, doing what I've just done, could have gone into another couple of properties. You know, I could have bought another couple of Victoria Avenues, cash flowing, you know, £1,000-£2,000 a month. But I've literally had to hand it over in finance costs, accountancy fees, solicitors' fees. And I think the tax bill was about 45,000. Now, I got off lightly with that tax bill because I didn't have a huge amount of capital gain. But so that was majority stamp duty. Luckily, I had more equity in the property. So when I refinanced it, it covered everything and, you know, gave me the money out to pay the tax bill.
Right.
Because I've bought in the last 10 years. So I've been buying, you know, buying well in the last 10 years. I haven't had huge increases, but landlords who have owned properties for serious lengths of time and have kept mortgaging, you know, they're really stuck now.
Right. What really strikes me is your attitude. Like, rather than moaning and complaining and resenting and fretting about it, you're just like, right, the law's changed. I got no choice. I just got to like restructure it and pay the bill, and I don't have a choice, and that's that kind of thing.
Yeah, absolutely. And don't get me wrong, there were a couple of effing and blinding and, you know, oh, shall I just send the keys down to Downing Street and walk away? You know, don't get me wrong, I did have that. But at the same time, it's short lived. You know, I get it off my chest, and then, like you said, I just get on with it. Mm. You know, that moaning makes absolutely no difference. Mm. And to it's what I call a hashtag first world problem. You know, if that's all I've got to worry about, my life is pretty freaking awesome. You know,
yeah.
If I've got to worry about my couple of million pound property portfolio having to like restructure to keep going, to keep being financially free, you know, my life is pretty peachy. I don't believe I have the right to moan a huge amount.
Yeah, yeah. I know it is a big topic, but just for any of the listeners that might know what we were talking about just then, just like a brief summary of what that was, that change in law. What did it mean for landlords?
Sure. So basically, for those that don't know, landlords have a mortgage interest expense. And to give you an example on mine, my mortgage interest is about £4,000 a month. In bills that I have to pay to mortgage companies, £4,000 to £5,000 a month. And I put that through my accounts as an expense. So just like any other business would have expenses and costs, that goes through against the profit, the rental profit, to you know, mitigate against tax. And what's happened with the tax change is the government has decided that that is no longer an allowable expense. So it means that all of a sudden I'm getting taxed on my effectively gross rental. So I'm getting taxed on £10,000-£11,000 a month. And that volume of cash takes me well into the 40-50% tax bracket, which means I'm paying tax at 40-50% on money that I physically don't have. So I would get taxed on the gross rent, pay my mortgage bill, and then by the time I pay my tax bill, there's not a huge amount left.
That's
effectively what it's done. It's effectively wiped out profit.
Yeah, it was for a lot of landlords, like you'd already said, that was a huge hit.
That was brutal. I mean, that was about as brutal as it gets, you know.
Yeah,
that changed. So we're going from, we've just had the recession, you know, and this is off the back of the recession with big losses, if there need to be realised. I mean, that's a slightly different point that we can sort of touch on. But, you know, we've had this huge recession and then we get this change. There's also legislation coming in to make landlords act more responsibly, which I have no problem about. I think it's absolutely brilliant, but it's put a lot of people off. So, you know, I really feel for the landlords that have one or two properties, kind of did it. They're known as accidental landlords. You know, maybe they couldn't sell a property and they're now lumbered with a lot of legislation, huge tax changes that have basically made their investment negligible.
Right. Yeah, yeah. Something I wanted to just kind of changing gears and flipping onto a different topic. I wanted to ask you, Landmark and Tony Robbins. This is more into the personal development side of things.
Sure.
What impact have those had during your journey?
So I would say that Landmark, out of every single piece of personal development I've done, has had the most huge transformational impact compared to anything. And I believe that's because of everything else I did before it. So I was ready to do the final shifts that I did with Landmark. Landmark's a pretty full-on transfer. You've done the Landmark Forum.
Yeah, I did the first one, and then I did a couple of the further seminars, yeah.
Yeah. So I believe if you're ready for it, Landmark is the most transformational thing out there. And I believe, it was all of the other things that I did that really led the way to me being ready for that, because it's a pretty full-on course, and it takes something to kind of go through that, and basically in a short version, Landmark gets you to take 100% responsibility for everything in my life, including all the stuff that I used to believe wasn't my fault or wasn't to do with me or I couldn't possibly be responsible for. So I would say that's been the most transformational, but on the back of all the other stuff. I still really, really like and respect Tony Robbins. I think the thing that's missing in the Tony Robbins work, and I don't think this is to do with Tony Robbins, I think this is to do with the size of his events, is that I believe that with personal development, everyone has got to be on their journey and find what works for them. And if you go on a course that's got 5,000 people in it, the message might not be specific to you. So for I'll give you a real life example. One of Tony Robbins' things is about, you know, like, he really pumps people up with loud music and exercise and physiology, which is absolutely bang on. You change your physiology, you completely change your state. I get that. And there's a certain amount that doesn't always work. So one of his messages is, you know, do more, be more, you don't need to sleep. You know, that's kind of how it comes across. You know, turn the music up loud and pump it. And that works for some people, but it doesn't work for everyone. Every human being on the planet has got where they're at and where they need to get. So, for example, for me, I'm really self-motivated. And if I add things into my life to force me to be even more motivated, it actually sends me over the edge and I don't sleep and I get really stressed. I don't need someone pushing me even harder than I already push myself. I actually need a coach saying, hang on a second, have you been to sleep? Have you chilled out? Have you spent time with your family? Have you eaten properly? And Tony Robbins also does that message, but I think it gets missed. Unless you're having personal coaching with Tony Robbins or one of his coaches, there's a lot that can be misunderstood on his seminars.
Yeah.
Because of that, you know, because there are people who need to be pushed more, and there are people who need to give themselves a break. There are people who already do a lot, and there are people who don't. And when you go to one course giving, you know, kind of a general message, I've experienced clients coming to me saying, yeah, but Tony says this. And it's like, yeah, but you're not that. So you're trying to take advice that's meant for someone else.
Mm.
So that's where I think having a coach who you actually speak to about your specific life is really important. So I think the courses that are, you know, that are big to go on, they're huge. I went on UPW. God, I can't remember. I've done it twice. And I think it took me 4 or 5 years to integrate everything I'd learned on that one weekend before I was kind of ready to go back in again. So it's an incredible thing to do. And I think the more transformational type courses that people do, the better. And I think alongside that, they need to have a coach that knows them. You know, a bit like you said, you're going to therapy now. That therapist knows specifically who Ben Lowrey is and has the conversations for Ben Lowrey. Mm. He's not speaking to you as an audience or a crowd.
Yes. Yeah.
And I think that's the difference. And like, I have a coach now who she's one of the landmark seminar leaders. And I really resonate with her work. And before that, it was Judy Mae Murphy. And I really resonated with her at that time for the stuff I was dealing with. But alongside all the books and the courses, I've always had a personal coach.
Yes, yeah. Do you know what?
I think that makes the difference.
It makes me think of my relationship with meditation, right? Mm-hmm. In terms of, I'm pretty calm and placid, but by my nature, I'm not an anxious person. My nervous system's very sort of like a still lake in a way. Mm. And you know, sometimes when people recommend meditation, for me, I don't need to meditate. It doesn't do anything
yeah.
for me.
Yeah.
Like
yeah,
for
exactly.
for me, I want to be stimulated. I want my nervous yeah. system revved up. That, you know, that's why yeah. I go to the gym and lift weights and do intense yeah. stuff and go to boxing and things like that, because I thrive on challenge. You know, I want resistance. I don't want to sit still. Like I don't need that. So I can relate to what you're saying.
Very similar thing. Yeah, it's like telling everyone they need to meditate, and it's just not true.
Yeah.
You know, I've got one client who I've recommended they do like self-defense and boxing classes because actually they need to take up more space. There's a couple of them that got, you know, this is usually guys more than women, but it can help with women too. You know, they need to take up some more space. They're sort of playing too small and they're kind of apologizing for existing. So doing meditation and yoga is going to make no difference. Going to boxing and self-defense classes.
Yeah.
It's going to make them stand up straighter.
Oh, I completely agree. That's kind of a topic I feel quite strongly about, actually, because, you know, I do a lot of fitness stuff, a lot of activities. Mm. And that is so true. You know, for some people, they do need to go to yoga and calm down.
Absolutely.
And do the whole
yeah.
gentle thing. And for yeah. some people, there's some people in that yoga class, they really would be better off in the boxing gym or powerlifting and revving themselves up and getting more in touch with their powerful
yeah.
side. It's like,
yeah, absolutely.
And so there is a category of person that should be doing the opposite.
yeah absolutely. And it's the same. I always remember reading in Louise Hay's book, You Can Heal Your Life. She said she never gives anyone dietary advice because everyone has to figure it out for themselves. And there's a lot in that. You know, we're all different in the sense of what works for us to eat. And it's why, you know, there are valid reasons for being vegan, and there are valid reasons for eating paleo, and there are valid reasons for, you know, every diet out there. It's because actually everyone's got to find out what works for their body. And it's the same with a lot of stuff.
How has being a mother changed your life?
Good question. Apparently it's chilled me out. I'm much calmer than I used to be. I'm really aware of, it's a magical thing to have a child and give birth and have this, you know, tiny creature that's completely dependent. And it's made me realize what's really important. And it has slowed me down and it has chilled me out. One of my one of the mortgage brokers I work with, we've had a few real big problems with mortgages lately. And he said on a few occasions, I can't believe how chilled out you are about this. You used to go mental. You know, motherhood must be really suiting you. And I think it is. I'm really aware of how Charlie will pick up on how I'm feeling. So if I'm getting stressed and tense and angry, which we all know makes no difference anyway, it's going to affect him. So it's definitely calmed me down. It's made me really enjoy being at home more, whereas I used to go out a lot and, you know, want to be out and about and busy. I guess since I've had him and while I was pregnant, I've done a lot of reading and learning and understanding about, you know, bringing up children. It's like life goes in full circle, right? I've spent a lot of time doing work on my own self, dealing with my own childhood, which, you know, to the outside world was pretty perfect. You know, I didn't have any major trauma. I've sat in codependence anonymous meetings feeling like I shouldn't be there because everyone else had, like, you know, they'd had some real serious shit happen to them. And I was sitting there going, I don't understand why I'm feeling like this. But, you know, there was stuff that happened that I'd made mean stuff that had made me feel bad. And it's almost like now I'm hyper aware of all of that. So I'm really interested in, you know, doing everything I can to make sure Charlie's childhood is as brilliant as it can be, in a way that just, you know, my mum did exactly the same for me. And I'm sure there will be things that happen that, you know, Charlie will not like, but I will do my damn best to make sure, you know, I'm there for him. I'm a big, I think it's Stephen, someone that you follow?
Stefan Molyneux.
Yeah, Stefan Molyneux. I didn't quite get on with how he is, but his content is very good. And it's all about, you know, peaceful parent. There's another American lady about to do with peaceful parenting, and it's all this like non-angry, non-violent parenting. And it's made me very aware of that and how I am around Charlie. But also then actually it's the same with how I interact with adults. You know, we've all got our inner child, and actually being angry or shouting and all the rest of it, it just doesn't work. And having spent 17 years in kitchens, which are pretty aggressive, violent places, for want of a better description, it's been a really interesting journey for me to actually look at how to, you know, be another way and how to communicate without being angry and frustrated.
I've never heard of codependence. What did you call it?
Codependence Anonymous.
I've never heard of that. What does that mean?
So it's a 12-step program. And you could argue that everyone that's in a 12-step program would actually benefit from going to Codependence Anonymous as well, because it's dealing with the actual behaviors of addiction. So codependency as a term came out of Alcoholics Anonymous, and codependence, the shortest way to describe it to you, codependents are the people that stay around alcoholics and enable their behavior. So There's a kind of funny saying in 12-step program that, you know, the alcoholic has got a good excuse for acting crazy because they're pissed, but the codependent really doesn't. They're stone cold sober and they hang around anyway. So it follows the 12 steps, but it deals with dysfunctional relationships. So if anyone's dealing with an constant intimate relationships that don't work, it's very good. Anyone dealing with trauma. So I went into Codependence Anonymous after the death of my brother and the breakdown of my marriage, because I was just like, my life is not working. So first step of any 12-step program is, you know, we admitted that we had a problem and that we're not functioning effectively. So, you know, alcoholics admit that they've got a problem with alcohol. So I just thought, this is, you know, my life is not functioning. It's falling apart in front of my eyes. You know, Chris dying, you know, there was nothing I could do about, but my marriage breaking up, you know, that didn't work. And I didn't really know why it had failed as well. I think that was the biggest thing. You know, I really had and still do have huge amount of love and respect for David. And it just wasn't, I couldn't understand why it wasn't working. So it was actually Judy May Murphy, who was my coach, who recommended going into it. And it was also some of the best work I've done. Especially if anyone listening to this is struggling with relationships and hasn't got a lot of cash, it's a really great place. You spend a couple of pounds to be in one of those meetings, which just covers the room, and you all coach each other and follow the 12 steps. So it's very valuable work. And again, what really crystallized stuff for me was Landmark. So I think Coda set the way for it, but Landmark got me to take responsibility. So codependents often present as victims, you know, myself included. It's not my fault. Why is this happening to me? I don't understand. When actually the reality is, underneath all of that, there's quite a lot of people pleasing, manipulation, trying to make everything okay, which is really dysfunctional behavior. And I know we're going a bit off track from property, but this is the kind of stuff that people have to deal with to then do that. You know, it's those dysfunctional kind of attributes that I had, which got me into Coda. My life wasn't working. You know, I've been divorced. Okay, I'm happily married again now, and you know, everything's working really well. But I've had a number of relationships that just didn't work, and didn't understand why. And what happened in Coda was I understood the behaviors. What happened in Landmark was I took responsibility for my part. So there's a lot of talk at the moment about narcissism and codependency. And actually, narcissists get painted as the big bad wolf, and codependents get painted as the poor white victim. And actually, what's true is that both are just doing coping mechanism behaviors to get through the day. Mm. And what's a shame is that narcissists get painted as horrible, and codependents kind of get excused because it's not their fault.
Right.
Whereas actually what's true, and if you want to take a live example, Donald Trump gets called a narcissist. He's just honest. He just says what he's thinking. And if people listened, I think you said this on your Facebook, if people listened to his whole conversation, they'd realize actually what he's saying, he has some value. Whereas a codependent will get off by being a victim, but actually what they're doing is people pleasing and manipulative, and it's very underhand. You know, and I'm including myself in that. It's underhand behavior, which people don't take responsibility for.
Yes. Yeah. That's powerful stuff. I'm going to look that up. That sounds very interesting to me. I'd like to, I'll look that up. I mean, I won't get into I've been through my own journey over the last several years of really, you know, relating to people in a way that was not working as well. And I understand what you mean, that feeling of I'm not sure what I'm doing wrong kind of thing. So I can relate to that, you know, perhaps we'll chat about it another time, but
yeah, definitely. Absolutely.
Just jumping back into the business stuff again, just for the people that are listening that are curious, that might want to get involved with more of your thing. So essentially you've got there's stage one and stage two. You've got your money bootcamp thing. What do you call it again?
So I've got money bootcamp, which is the 4-month program, which is the lead into and the foundation for joint venture mastermind. So people have to complete money bootcamp. Or, I mean, I've got one joint venture group, which they haven't done money bootcamp, but they were all existing one-to-one clients. So they'd done it, but in a one-to-one type format.
So like,
and then I put them all together.
So the money bootcamp is like the training academy to get people on track, to get them all sorted out. And then if they kind of graduate and if they're suitable, then they can start joint venturing in real world sort of property
in real world terms, actually, you know, the rubber hits the road, as they say, in that. And that, I mean, that's literally, it's 4 to 6 people once a year. I am working on an online version, but I haven't quite figured how to do that yet. I think we'll do a certain amount online, but there will still be coaching involving me, which is really just to deal with the fact that there are more people who want to work with me than I can handle. I'm working on doing some online stuff so that works, but that's coming, you know, later.
And what books would you recommend, and what people do you follow online?
So the first book I always get people to read is Rich Dad, Poor Dad. And if they say, oh, I've read it, but I think they're not sort of, they haven't got it, I recommend they read it again. And then there's also one of his other books that I really like is Unfair Advantage by Robert Kiyosaki. And then so I follow Robert Kiyosaki. I think his cash flow game is brilliant. I mean, I use it myself as a tool with my groups. And then property people, there's not really a huge amount actually that I follow. It's more all of the other work. You know, it's all of the other type dealing with relationships and all the rest of it.
I see. Also, you are based in South Wales. Do you only do deals in South Wales?
So I own properties in England and up north, but generally, yes, I do, because I believe actually it's really handy having them on the doorstep. The figures work for me. And so I stay here. But there, you know, there are people who if they live up north, I'd recommend they do deals up north. And if they live in Scotland, I recommend they do it up there. This idea of going somewhere else to do deals is weird to me, unless you live in London and it's just not going to work. So you have to go out of area. I believe that the closer you can do stuff to home, the better.
Mm, yeah. Okay. So if people want to get in contact with you, what's the best way of doing that?
They can find me on Facebook. So it's Alexlouise Thomas. They can find me on Instagram as well. Do you know, I don't even know my Instagram name. They can send me an email. So it's probably the easiest thing is alexlouise7@gmail.com. And just drop me a line and either myself or Sarah, my PA, will get back to them. But Facebook is probably the easiest way.
Okay. Is there a website at the moment?
Find me through you. There isn't a website at the moment. I'm working on it to do some of the online stuff. But I've never had a website or even a business card because all my stuff comes through referrals and, you know, people hearing things like this. Or seeing me speak.
That's a really good sign. I mean, there's something really reassuring about that. Like a business person that doesn't have a website, you know, they are really hustling via like one-to-one interactions. Well,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm doing one not under duress, but I'm doing one now because it's serving what people need rather than because it's not a marketing tool. It's to allow people to have, you know, access to the stuff that I do. There's my marketing is it's all word of mouth. Everyone that comes to me is through referral, through someone who already works with me usually, or has heard something like this. So I had a great conversation. So I have to thank you for that really. With someone the other day who they'd heard your original podcast and they'd seen me speak for Funding in London, or they'd seen a recording of it maybe, and they'd heard the London Late Night Talks podcast, and then they contacted me. So, you know, they it's sort of not through a direct referral, but it's through hearing something like this and saying, you know, liking what I do. And I think that's important for anyone listening. You've got to find a coach that resonates with you, that you can't, like, it's no good coming to work with me just because someone says come and work with me. If you then speak to me and think, oh, I'm not really sure, it's not going to work. It's got to be like, oh, yeah, I get what Alex is saying. I get this message. It's like when people come to you, Ben, they like what you're doing, whether it was the guitar lessons or your handstand stuff or your networking stuff. There's going to be they resonate with your message and they're going to come and work with you. Mm-hmm. So for anyone listening who is thinking, oh, yeah, you know, after I've heard this, I really want to get a coach, find someone that works in the area that you want to achieve and keep speaking to people and find someone that resonates. Don't just work with someone because you think you should.
Mm. Is there any networking events or like you mentioned Funding? I haven't heard of that one, but what live events or groups or seminars would you recommend for networking?
I think it depends what you want to achieve. So when I had a catering business, I was doing BNI, which is a Business Network International, I think it stands for. Very structured, very early morning meetings, very, you know, commitment orientated. But then there are other kind of more, you know, loose, fun things like 4N was another one in South Wales. There was a network lunch. There's all sorts of different things. I think it's finding something that resonates.
Mm. Yeah. Okay.
And yours. I mean, I haven't been to your event, but I can imagine it's pretty awesome because you're coming at networking from a wholly different, you know, a wholly different way than all the other ones. You know, the ones I mentioned are very, if you have a business that you want to get out there, they're a good one, whereas you're looking at, it sounds like from what I've seen of, you know, what you've put up, looking at actually planning and what do people want to achieve rather than just selling.
Yeah, that's right. I've run one of them. Really, I've called it Journey, just in case people haven't heard of it. But
awesome name. You know, it's like,
yeah. Yeah, and it's more on the emotional sort of self-work side of things, you know, as opposed to, just like sort of business kind of thing. It's more the emotional. Yeah, so I'll be doing more of that over Christmas. I'm going to plan some new dates and yeah, sort of schedule some new stuff. So we loosely sort of agreed that we were going to talk some about my like my specific stuff, and you know, are you happy to like carry on talking about that, or should we stop the Skype call? Or I'm happy to leave it going.
I'm happy to leave it going if it, you know, if it adds value and it works, because you can always take it off if it doesn't, you know, whatever. Yeah, it's cool.
Yeah, that's fine.
Let's carry on.
I've got no secrets, so I'm happy for people to hear anything that I say. So yeah.
Everyone now knows that I've done coder and you're in therapy, so they're kind of getting a picture of, you know, how real we are. And you know, it's not BS, so
It's
it's just a continuation of that, isn't it?
a nice feeling actually when you feel like you've got nothing to hide, nothing to be embarrassed about. That's a wonderfully free feeling, isn't it?
It's huge, and I think most people spend a lot of time feeling awkward because they're hiding. And actually, I love the way Brené Brown says, you know, about how powerful being vulnerable is. You know, and actually, to be vulnerable and say who we really are, we think it's going to kill us. You know, we feel like we're going to die if we dare say what we're actually dealing with. But what usually happens is people go, "Oh my God, yeah, me too." And it's very freeing if you can, you know, feel the fear and do it anyway, as Susan Jeffers says.
Do you know what? I know this is a little bit of a tangent, but I've got a bit of a fascination with Mike Tyson because I find he's one of those people that he has no filter. Like, you know, when he's interviewed, whatever the truth is will just come out of his mouth. And he's got this kind of fit. He's got this, yeah, he'll say whatever he's thinking, no matter how awkward or embarrassing or vulnerable it is. You know, he cries all the time in interviews. He's very emotional. He's very sensitive, and I really admire that because it's especially from a tough guy. There's something that I find fascinating about, you know, because he's got nothing to prove in the world. He's already done it all. He's as tough as you could be, and yet he's still there, emotional, you know, crying about something that happened or something that he's, and I find him very fascinating for that reason. But
Yeah,
anyway.
I've not watched any of his interviews, so I can't comment on him personally, but from a point of view of, yeah, absolutely. You know, if someone's sharing and being authentic, then for sure it's a great thing. That there's a balance between what Brené Brown would call oversharing and sharing, where, you know, some people will just tell everyone everything and it's inappropriate. But you know, if someone's sharing and being authentic about something that happened to them in an interview and is getting emotional, you know, fantastic.
Yeah.
You know, more power to them. If, you know, more of us could be like that, absolutely, the world would be a more caring, understanding place. Because while we're all putting on fronts and pretending everything's okay, you know, it doesn't work.
So, in terms of me becoming involved with what you're doing, I have no idea what I have got to offer. You know, I don't have capital. So, what is there a place for me in your world?
Absolutely. You know, I have plenty of people that come and say, you know, I don't have the capital, and it really isn't about that. Yes, it helps, and yes, there will be people in the groups that do have capital, and there will be people in the groups that have family members that have capital. It's about all the things that need to be done, and having capital is just one element of doing a property deal. And yes, it's clearly important. Without capital, you know, we can't buy anything. And I am certainly not from the school of thought, you know, these adverts that people see, and you know, anyone that's doing it, you know, more power to you. I really great that you're doing it. But for me, this whole no money down, no mortgage, no credit score needed, you know, don't worry, you can still buy property, I don't buy into that. So don't misunderstand that when I say, you know, you've got no capital, it's not a problem. What I mean by it's not a problem is what really counts to be in property is eagerness, enthusiasm, persistent, consistent action, showing up, doing what needs to be done. So, for example, for you specifically, it's about being in the group, showing up, doing the work, dealing with your money and your business and whatever. The capital comes, you know, through the group saving as a whole, you know. And some of my groups, I think one group started on 50 quid a month. You know, they pay my coaching fees separately. That's, you know, that's their investment in themselves. And then they started at saving £50 a month, because that was where all of them were at financially. They didn't have any spare cash. And then what they went to work on was, they went, okay, we want to aim to get to £200 a month saving. So they worked on their own lives and what they needed to do, whether it be, you know, cutting out buying Starbucks or earning a bit more money on a side hustle, so they could all get to £200 a month. And when you've got five people in a group saving £200 a month, that's £1,000 a month. So instead of trying to do it on your own, which is really damn slow, all of a sudden it's multiplied by five. And £1,000 a month is £12,000 a year, which is well on the way to a deposit for a property, right? So that's one aspect of building capital as a group. There will always be someone in the group, if not a couple of people in the group, who have savings, who are like, I'm going to put this in. They may not be able to put the time in. So, for example, I've got one guy at the moment who is via you looking at your group, who's going to travel down from Glasgow every month to come to the workshop. And he's like, you know, I'm concerned about how much I can give in the sense of time and location, you know, and it's like, it's not about that. There'll be other people in the group that are on the ground. So, for example, you're going to be living in Newport, right? Mm. I put you guys in that group together. You're on the ground. He's got some savings and a bit more availability of cash. All of a sudden, bang, that's a joint venture. Mm. A joint venture works when everybody in the group needs each other, when everybody individually can't do what it takes to get financially free. But when they pull together, they can. So what you lack at the moment, and I'm going to say at the moment in capital resources, you will have in time and being on the ground, for example. Yeah. And it's the same, like we were talking about James earlier, you know, he's living in Bristol. And so it's harder for him to be on the ground here. But boy, is he a flipping amazing whiz with spreadsheets and detail. The group doesn't move ahead without James saying, okay, I understand this. I've got it. He will nail down every piece of detail. He will hold the guys to account when it comes to them budgeting and working out a cost. He'll go, you know, is there anything else? What else is there? He'll put it all in a spreadsheet. He'll make sure the deal stacks. He is invaluable to that group when the rest of the people in that group are more, you know, on the ground, get it done, figure it out as they go along. They need that detail person. So do you see how it's like, it's really powerful that everyone brings what they bring to the table? I suspect, having known you for a long time, what you'll also bring is like, come on, guys, let's get this done. And that enthusiasm and that looking at things in a different way. You know, you've done so much personal development work yourself. That in itself is incredibly powerful, because the more personal development work anyone's done, the more self-aware they are, the better in conversations they are, the better they can deal with stuff that arises, the more, I'm going to use the word optimistic they are, but in a sense of, we know what's possible. Mm. I mean, you've listened to, I believe, a lot of Abraham stuff, right?
Yeah.
You know, and that's, I mean, I use their cards, their Money and Law of Attraction cards by Esther and Jerry Hicks. I use them in my groups just to wake people up about, it's not what's going on now, it's what's possible in the future. It's what you talk about, it's where you spend your attention. And that's the answer I would also give to people who haven't got capital. It's like, you might not have it right now, but that doesn't mean it's not there.
Right. Okay. So I'm a valid candidate to become involved then.
100%.
Okay.
Absolutely. That's why I said, Ben, I need you on the team.
Okay.
It's like, it really is, you know, it's not anyone can just jump in this. It's like, I put groups together that work with people that I know are gonna gel and be expansive. It's not the program that works. It's the people that work. It's not my coaching that works. It's the people doing and taking the assignments and the coaching that work. You know, there's no coach out there that can claim anyone else's success. We might facilitate your success, but it's you guys that do it. You know, the guys that are in my groups already that are doing it, it's them that did it. I might have been there to hold the space, and I might have facilitated it, and I might have said, oh, well, have you looked at this? And no, that won't work because legally you have to do it that way. But it was them that did the work. Mm. They showed up, they did the work, they worked on their money, they worked on their businesses, they worked on saving, they worked on their relationships with everyone in their lives and also each other. And I you know, I take no credit for that. I'm absolutely privileged and grateful to be, you know, able to hold that space for people. I don't take my position lightly in that sense. You know, people are giving me a lot of time and attention and paying me to do what I do. And, you know, I feel really privileged.
Wow.
To be in that position.
I remember years ago, me and my dad sort of had a go at some projects, and I was going around the estate agents and looking, you know, I was looking, I mean, Yeah, and I enjoyed doing that. I was like trying to find, you know, find the deals, find the properties and stuff. And I enjoyed that. And I enjoyed doing the numbers and like figuring out what the rent would be and da 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 and what the I enjoyed like figuring out what the cash flow would be and what the interest rate would be and all that. I guess I imagine that would be a valuable part of the process.
Absolutely, because there are people who just they're not interested, you know. I think everyone really does bring different things to the table. You know, it's like James's group now. There's one of them's in charge of like dealing with maintenance and contractors and the bills. There's another one that's dealing, well, James is dealing with all the spreadsheets and the banking and the accountants. Another of them is very good at talking to the tenants. So she's talking to the tenants and kind of she's like people relations, right? And then there's another guy that actually does the tenancy agreements and the deposit protections and all that side. So everyone's got, they do the bits that they're good at. I'm a great believer in getting people to do what they really enjoy and what they're good at. I'm not into this school of thought, you know, a bit like when we send kids to school and we go, oh, they need to get better at what they're not good at. It's complete nonsense. You know, we need to get better at the things we're good at because then we're really going to fly. And the things that we're not good at, find someone else that is.
Yeah, right. This might sound like a real minor concern, and but one of the things that bothered me is I know that I often work at weekends. I teach handstands on Sundays. I do hand parties on Saturdays, and I know James was saying some of the group get-togethers were on Sundays, and is that an obstacle?
Lucky for you, this group's going to be in the weekdays.
Right.
And that is, I'd already set that up because I already have three groups that meet at weekends. So my weekends are getting eaten into. And although Owen works 2 weekends out of four, which gives me, you know, 4 weekend days a month to work when he's working, I find, you know, family time to me is really important. So the caveat of this group is it's in weekdays. So it's a non-concern at this point for you now. Some of the other people that are going to be in the group, Sarah, my PA, is one of them. She's watched what, you know, everyone else is doing and gone, hang on a second, I want a piece of this. She's got 2 young children and weekends are sacrosanct for her, so she needs to be, you know, working in the weekdays. So no, it's the ones that are at the weekends are because the people in the group are in full-time employment, you know, a bit like James, he's in full-time employment, so are a couple of the other people in his group. So it works best for them to meet at weekends.
If there was a scenario where somebody in one of your groups was like doing their own like investments separately on the side, does that work as well? Like if they wanted to buy a property separately from.
It does. What's interesting and what's happened that I didn't actually expect to happen, didn't plan for, was that all, so another group, they all individually had their own buy-to-let property. So they'd managed to do one on their own. Do you know what they've done? They've put it into the company jointly. So they've actually put their properties into the company because it's much easier to manage. So the answer to it is absolutely, people can go off and do their own stuff on the side. What actually generally happens is that everyone goes, holy shit, this is way easier doing it as a team. And there's only one set of limited company fees and there's only one set of accounting fees. So actually, if we pool all our resources just into this one company, it's even more powerful. Which again, I really didn't expect. You know, that's come out of me following and holding the group to where they end up going. And what they all worked out was, hang on, if I have my own property and my own limited company, I have all those fees, all that hassle, all that work, when actually it could be dealt with.
And when you
As a group.
establish a group, do you plan the contingencies in advance? Like if somebody wants to leave, if somebody wants to take their share, is that all figured in advance?
So there's actually some pretty serious legal company agreements that are written up, signed, and lodged. I think they're actually lodged with Companies House. That, you know, because a limited company is a legal entity, right? So you have to have these things in place. Well, you don't have to have them in place, but it's recommended. So all of that is pre-agreed. The bonus for the groups that are coming up, like I'm going to call it your group, speak what I want in advance. Is that all these agreements are already written and have been discussed and talked about. So it's even easier for the next groups to use those agreements. They still need to read them, understand them, tweak them. There's a lot of legal speak in them. But we don't even look at a property until those are done, so that everybody absolutely knows what happens if someone leaves, if someone dies, how that looks. If, especially if someone dies, the family understand how it happens, because obviously they've got, you know, they've got, they're a shareholder. So each person is an equal share director and shareholder. And it's all written in the agreement what that would look like if someone dies, how long the group has to buy someone out, that no one else can take that person's place unless the group all decides that they don't mind other people coming in. But what I recommend is that that doesn't work, that you're better off paying someone's shares out. Because otherwise you're dealing with, you know, someone can just come in and do what they want, you know, who's not part of the group, who hasn't been through the coaching, who I haven't pre-approved, and all of a sudden you've got carnage in a company. So yeah, all of that is taken care of. Everybody has to have a will. Everyone has power of attorneys, which dictate if they're incapacitated mentally and physically, what happens, you know, the whole thing. We have a lot of fun, and I take it extremely seriously as well. So it's a good balance of everything.
That's very reassuring, because yeah, that was one of my you know, the things I was wondering, like, you know, because I'm capable of being obnoxious and falling out with people historically, right?
Yeah.
I'm not saying that would happen, but it could happen.
Absolutely.
And knowing in advance, like, what if we fall out? What if we all hate each other? You know, what?
Yeah.
And just knowing that the scenarios are already agreed in advance is a great, that's essential, isn't it?
And the irony is that because that's in place, generally people don't fall out. It's a double-sided coin, right? So because you put all that in place, the thing then that you've planned for doesn't actually happen. And if it does, it does. You know, but generally that's where I earn my money. You know, when people do butt heads. You know, I've got one group with two of the guys. They're brilliant. You know, they're so alike. It's funny, and they don't fall out, but they have what I call is a breakdown in communication. And it takes something to get everybody back on track. But each time there is a breakdown, it makes the group even stronger. So, you know, I don't believe there's anything wrong or bad in breakdowns. I think they need to happen for growth. Mm. You know, you've got to break down before you break through effectively. You know, people who go through life never having breakdowns, I would suggest, are avoiding them rather than they're not there.
Yes, right. It's inevitable, isn't it? If you work with a group of people. Yeah.
You know, you work with a group of people, you're doing financial investment, money is bringing up all people's stuff, you know. Money's intrinsically linked to every area of their life. Everyone will have their childhood stuff around their money that, even if they've done money bootcamp and dealt with it to a certain level, they still may get triggered. You know, everyone's dealing with all their stuff. Stuff's going to happen for sure.
Yeah. No, that's great. That's wonderful. That's great. I don't have any particular questions at this moment. So what's your thoughts in terms of, like, how do we need to move forward? What's the next step?
Awesome. So, yeah, I was going to say, so my question is, are you in?
I'm in.
Awesome.
100%.
Exciting, exciting. So basically what happens next is I've got a few more conversations to have to finalize the last few people, because I've got six people on my list. Three of them will, you know, end up in the group because there's three of you already. So I need to have those conversations, which I've committed to my coach to have by Sunday, to get things moving. And then what we'll do is we'll schedule, well, Sarah, who will actually be in your group, but she's also my PA, so you'll have to know when she's dealing with you as PA and when she's in the group. She will actually then send out invoicing and questionnaires and everything to get everyone started. Mm. Because basically this work starts as soon as you join up. It doesn't happen, you know, in January, February when we have our first workshop. It starts straight away. So Sarah will send all that out to you. We will then schedule a call with all of you on so that we can have like an introduction call. And in that call, we'll also set up a WhatsApp group so everyone can start communicating already effectively.
Yeah.
And then we will also schedule through Doodle the actual dates. So I don't pre-say, right, guys, these are the dates, because if one of you can't make it, that doesn't work. I need all of you there for every single workshop and webinar. Mm. Sometimes we can, you know, say, okay, the webinar is more content driven. You can catch up on the recording because I record everything specifically just for the group. I don't use the recordings for anything else. But generally I like everyone to be there, you know, most of the time. So we'll schedule the dates that work for everybody.
Yes. That makes sense. Yeah.
And away we go. And welcome on board. I'm super excited, like really stoked.
Yeah, me too. Yeah, I completely trust you, and I can't wait to begin.
Woohoo!
So shall we leave it there on that note?
On that awesome bombshell. Yes, why not? That's awesome. And so, yeah, I'll be in touch with you in the next few days, probably early next week.
All right then, Alex.
Awesome, Ben.
All right, I look forward to speaking to you soon.
And when are you moving? Because you're going to be like down the road, so we get to have even more cool conversations and
Monday.
Chats. Anyway, super cool. drop me a line then and we'll catch up next week anyway.
All right. Okay. I'll speak to you soon.
Awesome. Thanks, Ben.
Bye for now.
Cheers.
Bye-bye.
Bye.